find there, but all things considered, we don't find that there's any sensitive biological resources with the exception maybe in those ditches, and those ditches will be preserved and protected. We did prepare a cultural resource study. The cultural resource study found that there is the potential for and the presence of archaeological materials. As such, we're incorporating conditions of approval within the use permit that require an on-site tribal monitor during the land disturbing activities. That will protect and avoid any disturbance of those archaeological resources should they be found during construction. We have some pretty heavy regulations for protection of storm water. Because the site's larger than an acre, we will need to prepare and draft a stormwater pollution prevention plan. That plan is actually already in the works and is being prepared, which will help protect water quality within the area. And due to its proximity to those ditches and the Napa River, that will be heavily regulated by the Regional Water Quality Control Board. So with those things noted, staff is in support of the use permit, and if the Planning Commission has any questions of me, I can answer those now. Or we have our Public Works Director, Mike Kern, in the audience, and City Manager Richards.
Okay, thank you.
Eric, will the SWIP plan incorporate also the 2-acre finger?
It will. There is some minor grading on there. There's some sloping that'll occur, so that since it's being disturbed, it will be.
And has there been any discussion from Chateau Calistoga on where there's a portion that gets near them relative to that property?
The 2-acre piece is adjacent to the mobile home park.
Small portion
of it, right. They've been noticed. They received a notice in the newspaper, postings on the board, posting on the website. We haven't received any concerns.
Great. Yes.
Any other questions? Okay. With that, we will open up the public portion of this item. Number one under the public hearings, recycled water storage pond. Oh, okay.
Doug Cook, 1447 2nd Street. Following up on your question, Mr. Wilkes, on the apparent lack of interest of Chateau Calistoga Mobile Home Park, I recall when this issue first came up months ago, there was quite a substantial concern over odors and construction noise and dust and those kinds of things. I would like to enter those concerns back into the record at this time. I've talked to a few folks there, and they seem to share those concerns. And I was wondering, particularly with regard to odors from the operation, what, if any, mitigation measures.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Doug Molitor. I live on the Foothill Drive. And last year, one of the city's fine journalists, Sean Scully, I'm sure many of us know him, wrote about the Lagunitas Brewery in Petaluma. And the Lagunitas has to truck their brewery waste to East Bay Mud every week because the city of Petaluma won't take it. And why? It's because the town doesn't have the ability to process the waste, so they put the burden back on the company. My point here is the town was unable to handle the waste products, and this is a major expanding business for them. In fact, it's a very highly publicized, successful entrepreneurial business. The town still refused to take the waste. Calistoga, on the other hand, is adopting a more Chinese model, we'll call it, where the government, not the polluters, are the ones who pay. You know, so we have two separate things going on here. We have a city government which refuses, makes the perpetrator pay, and there's Calistoga where the city pays. Now, I know some of you are going to say, Doug, you're going up the wrong way. It's too expensive for a business. But my belief is nobody's actually done the research. We know that mineral filtering, mineral precipitation, this technology is well proven. Many industries, food, pharmaceutical, high tech, use these processes. It's very, very well-known technology. And then I read about the pumps. And I'm thinking, just maybe there are some similarities here. Similarities such as, is it the best for the task, or what fit the budget? Similarities maybe in pumps being specified properly, or would we just get what was familiar? And then we all know that the acquisition of those pumps was a disaster. And it was a disaster because the city commission employed a high level of trust and a low level of fiduciary responsibility. I think some of that fiduciary responsibility comes down to this commission. I repeat, it was the high level of trust in the people that said these were the things, this is what to do, but a low level of responsibility in looking at alternatives. The same seems true with this proposal on the table. The city hasn't looked for a wider set of solutions in technology, financing, and the long-term water issues. So so we come here to discuss not a 21st century mineral removal problem, but adoption of a 2,000-year-old Roman solution, a settling pond. I mean, and why are we doing this? Because it's the easiest, it's by far the cheapest, and it's the most brain-dead recommendation that can be made. Now, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there's a wealth of data that's been researched about alternatives. I don't know. But I get that feel, because I get that feel from the pump issue, too. Also, it's a water issue. Settling pond does not address any of the water issues. It treats water as if it were available and abundant. And so we're debating again, if there's any debate, about a first century Roman answer to a 21st century resort issue. And we don't know what to do about the lack of water. And all we can do is hope that it'll rain. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Would anyone else like to address the commission?
Good evening, Chairman, Commissioner members. My name is Mike Kern. I'm the Public Works Director. I'd like to comment on some of the questions or statements that have been made. Number one, following up on Sweepy and the storm water pollution prevention plan that has been prepared, and it was filed with the Department of Water Resources today, so they have that document and they're reviewing. As far as cultural resources, as part of our CEQA analysis, we did physical testing of the site, we had auger testing done, and then we also had a backhoe come out there for several days with qualified cultural historian, where they dug trenches across the property at select locations, physically screened the material that was excavated. There were no evidence of significant cultural resources, just some small obsidian chips found, but nothing that rose to the level of importance of a cultural site. The water that will be stored there is tertiary treated, recycled water. It's the same water that is distributed back in town for irrigation, the high school play fields, Logan Park, and the golf course. So this is the highest treated water that the plant produces. The pond is not part of our primary treatment process, where raw wastewater is delivered to that. In fact, just the opposite. It's a holding facility for the end product. So there are no odors associated with the water. It's the same water that's currently applied spray field. There's no net difference in the quality of water that reside. It's just in a different form, pond form versus a spray form. this is an issue that is being driven primarily because of the drought. We have a 10-to-1 dilution ratio that we have to meet when we discharge to the Napa River. The late fall and early spring, there aren't those flows in the river, can't discharge. But wastewater keeps coming into the plant. So we can only store it for so long before we have to do something. Regional board executive officer has authorized us on those occasions to over-irrigate the spray fields, which in turn, there's incidental runoff, which is then discharged into the river. That, their opinion and our, my opinion, is a more preferable solution than a direct discharge to the river, because we do gain some filtration, some polishing of the effluent over land. And two, we don't maintain positive control of the wastewater facility. We have breach in our levees or our ponds, which is not good. So this gives us a better opportunity to manage that wastewater. It will provide an additional 16 plus million gallons of storage, which is equivalent of about 40 degrees of dry weather flow. So it gives us that cushion that we currently don't have. This is a very cost-effective solution problem. We did look at other options. We looked at leasing adjacent property for ponds, three existing ponds immediately adjacent to our facility. Property owners were not entering agreement of their facilities. We are in the final stages of being approved for a $700,000 grant from the Department of Water Resources specific to this project, which will cover probably 60% of overall costs. So not only do we believe that it's cost effective, it has also been competitive on a statewide basis for grant funding. So with that, I think it's appreciate your support of the project. Any questions?
I have two questions. If we used this year, this sort of disastrous year, as a model, will this facility have enough capacity to give you the bridge that you need?
Probably. This year we re-irrigated, I want to say, about 16 days.
So it's close.
It's close. It's part of a larger solution,
yeah.
But it's one that is readily constructible in a reasonable time frame, and has a high cost benefit ratio.
And you will then continue with the over irrigation?
Only if we have to.
Only if you have to. And that, and the over irrigation is tertiary treated?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Other than that, I had called Public Works yesterday and had a few questions relative to what I felt were some opportunities, but was satisfied that they didn't exist. So I have no other issues.
You mentioned as an option. Are there any other ways of doing this? If money was not an issue, I don't know anything about the way the system works now.
So if money were no issue, the next thing that, and it's something that we will be investigating, is what is our biggest challenge for additional beneficial reuse, primarily for agricultural purposes, is the fact that treated wastewater has a higher concentration of boron than grapes can tolerate. Our average concentration is about 2.8 milligrams per liter. Vines have a threshold of about 0.5. So if money were no object, the solution would be to put in the next level of advanced treatment, remove boron. That is achieved through primary methods, ion exchange or reverse osmosis. Both of them have different capital costs. One is more expensive up front, the other is more expensive long-term operational. So should we determine that we need to go there, be analyzing those two methods of treatment, which is the most economical long-term, if we have to do that. Once, if the water is treated to that higher degree, then it would be, the next hurdle would be finding receptive users who would be willing to take the water in lieu of other sources of irrigation. And then it's, how do we get it to them? So it's making a product that they're willing to accept and finding a way to get it to them. So money were no object, that's what we would do. But we're talking multiple millions of dollars and multiple years of effort.
I had a quick question. Is there room to expand this further if needed, or would the fallback be to continue with that type of technology?
There's not much ability to expand at this location. Note on your exhibit, property is kind of an L-shaped property. Focusing on the larger rectangular area, but not towards park. That was a decision based on economics. I don't get very much return on my investment for digging on. Spend a lot of money to get a small amount of storage, so it's allowed. One of the things that we will be looking at are there other areas that we can either provide additional irrigation on open space areas that, you know, can handle the boron concentrations, such as a golf course or other open space properties. That's the next thing.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I focused on the impacts of the facility that under consideration here. Other folks have raised questions about technology and other issues to be dealt with in our wastewater treatment plant, et cetera. I'd like to speak to the technology issue in two ways. One is the city consider a lined reservoir for this property. That's very common practice for freshwater. Sorry, Dean, appreciate that. Sorry, you want to contain it, you'd like it to evaporate or flow into the ground, but that addresses other issues. Finding is considered. And secondly, on the treatment for some of the chemicals, minerals that we're concerned about, boron, antimony, arsenic, and others, I refer back to Mr. Molitor's comments about the issue of polluter pays. One of the reasons that process works in general, that quantities are smaller to be treated, concentrations are higher at the source, and therefore perhaps the real cost of treatment would not be borne entirely by the citizen. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks for your comment. Anyone else wish to address the commission? Okay, we'll close the public portion and open it up to commission discussion. Anybody have anything?
A question, I guess I should have done it during public, but Mr. Maltor's statement about the brewery in Petaluma, I'm just curious on a scale, how big, Doug, do you know how big that brewery is in comparison to the, we have the little, you'd have to come up to the mic. You'd have to come up to the mic, Doug, so everybody could hear you. I'm sorry. I was just curious. I was very interested in it, but I don't know the size of what you're referring to.
The brewery actually is in the process of doubling there in Petaluma, its size. The amount of waste is one of those gondola trucks every week. So I suppose that means there are two when expansions.
Because we don't have a very large, we have small, like, boutique-type things, like wineries, you know, and breweries, but nothing of any stature here. I was just curious how that compares to the one that you were referring to.
In Petaluma. I just talked about the Petaluma one.
Right, but I was interested in that, and you were talking about how they have to haul it and how it has such a major impact, and Petaluma would not accept the waste.
Right.
But is it that large? Obviously, it's not a Budweiser, but is it that? Oh. What size is it in comparison? Because the few that we have are so small here. I wonder if that, at this moment anyway, is an issue.
I have no idea. They measure breweries, I think, in barrels of beer, and I have no idea how big it is, except that they are currently doubling whatever capacity they did have. Very successful. And I think Mr. Cook understood very well that if you get this at the end of the business pipeline, it's a very small and manageable. Not saying it's not expensive, but it's small and manageable. Whereas you put it into the public wastewater, then suddenly it covers. Let's use the term pollute. It pollutes the wastewater, which begins as drinking water in this town. Almost all the wastewater comes out of the faucet. Drinking quality water. It pollutes that so it's unusable. So if you started with the point of discharge from the polluter, you would not have a lot of problems we have with dumping into the river because you wouldn't have chemicals. And I think everybody's been here long enough to know that. I just am obviously very interested in the point that we don't know. I mean, is this an easy thing now to do? The reverse osmosis and the ion exchange and all these things have gone through great change in the last 15 or 20 years because of basically the high tech and pharmaceutical processes that require very clean water. And so is a small circuit to move boron and antimony, is that, I don't know what that costs. I'm not sure that's the city's job to tell us that, do that research. But my point is that if we've removed it at the point of pollution, wouldn't have the wastewater problem we have, because we could then more readily use the river as a conduit to get it out when there's a flow.
We're doing that very much so.
Okay, Chairman Freddie, could I just remind the commission that this is a hearing on this actual storage pond, right? And we're not looking at the overall wastewater system. The council has already directed staff to apply for the funding for this pond, and this is a land use entitlement for this particular pond and the conditions of approval that are proposed to you. Not more the council's purview to look at the entire wastewater system, so we're just trying to focus on this one project at hand.
Okay. Anyway, thanks for your comment.
Sure.
Richard Spittler, city manager. Just want to point that they're mixing apples and oranges together. There's an issue of boron, which does appropriate rates, adaptive reuse. But that is a separate issue in this storage pond where water builds up. And we can't put it in. If we were able to strip out the boron, which we may someday, or eliminate it at point source to where it could be used for great agriculture use, guess what? We're going to need a storage pond to put it in, then distribute it out to the receiving vineyards. So in my opinion, the storage pond solves the problem right now when we can't discharge it to whether it has boron or not, and two, in the future, if we're able to eliminate or reduce the boron to levels to where the agriculture will accept it, we'll have a pond to store it and then pipe it. So this is a win-win going in the future. And design of this, we pulled away from Chateau Mobile Home Park, so it's not going to be behind them. And so we think safeguarded their concerns. And this treated effluent tertiary does not have an odor. In fact, it's the same water that's been spraying behind those for decades now. So it's here.
Thank you for your comment. Okay, any other comments?
Well, I would like to say I have no issue with this proposal at all. I think that all of the comments you made are at the front end of what I'll call sewage treatment. This is at the back end of sewage treatment. I can't see any nexus between the two right now. Mr. Spittler's comment, you can never have enough water storage in any water treatment plant. I think that probably the best water treatment facility in the state of California is in the city of Irvine. And they have an abundance of storage facilities, which from a waterfowl standpoint is God's gift to the world. And is wonderful to walk through. I mean, they actually hold weddings there. So I don't see a downside to this. And I think your comments are good, but I think you're taking them to the wrong form. You're talking about policy, and I don't think we're setting policy here. We're looking at land use. I don't have an issue.
Okay, with that being said, would someone like to...
I move that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution approving a use permit allowing construction of a recycled water storage pond on city property which is associated with the city's wastewater treatment plant located at 1100 Dunwheel Lane.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? We'll go to item number 2 under public hearings. That is an update of the circulation element of the Calistoga General Plan, GPA 2014-2. This update is required by the state of California and provides a long-term comprehensive plan to address the city's transportation needs, including the provision of complete streets. With that, may we have a staff report?
Thank you. As you noted, we are required by the state to update our circulation element before we can update our housing element. So it has not been comprehensively updated since 2003, so we are taking this opportunity to do so, primarily to, again, incorporate complete streets, which is the concept of incorporating all modes of transportation. So it's not just vehicle focused, but it also includes what is called alternatives, such as walking and cycling. We also looked at the various improvements that were proposed in the 2003 general plan and recommended some changes to that, and those are some of the highlights are bulleted in your written staff report. There's an exhibit, exhibit CIR3, which shows those on the locations of the various intersection improvements, et cetera, that are proposed. We've also given you a copy of the draft active transportation plan, which will be going to the council next month. In a couple of weeks, to demonstrate that we haven't really ignored pedestrian and cycling. It's now in its own standalone document. And that one of the reasons for that is so it can be amended more frequently to respond to changes and priorities or projects. So while there is still reference to pedestrians and cyclists in the circulation element, that's primarily addressed in active transport. So this would be a recommendation to the City Council for adoption of the element, and I'd be happy to answer any questions. And Director Kern is still here if you have questions on any specific project.
Thank you. Do any commissioners have any questions? Okay, we will open up the public portion of this item. portion. Open it up to discussion. Does any commissioners have anything like to add regarding general plan amendment and circulation update?
Well, I would just like to compliment staff's preparation of this. I think it was, it's a vast improvement on what it was. And I think it's definitely moving in the right path. And to get Lincoln Avenue not designated Highway 29 can't happen soon enough for me.
Yeah, I second that. And I think almost everyone is
I agree. Are we in? Have we taken any steps to actually make that happen? I know that's not really, but interesting to know.
Good evening, Mike Kern, Public Works Director. Not at present. We've got a few other projects that we're working with Caltrans on, focusing on Berry Street Bridge replacement. It's a little bit off our radar screen, but not complete.
Okay. One more thing, just something that scares me is Brannon and Lincoln. You know, kids cross there to go to school. It seems very dangerous, and hopefully we can do. Well, I know it's Caltrans, but have that something happen there sooner than later.
We've included in our transportation plan that we submitted to NCTA some improvements on the Lincoln corridor, specifically for pedestrian safety enhancements, and what we're looking at Cedar and at Brannon are some form of either in pavement crosswalk lighting or advanced detection system. Call it a hawk. It's basically a pedestrian traffic signal.
Okay, I don't see anyone jumping up and down.
I move that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution recommending to the City Council adoption of the 2014 circulation element update of the Calistoga General Plan.
Second.
Second. Okay, we have a motion and a second for us. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That is a very nice report. I feel when I can understand it, it's a good report. So, do any commissioners have any items they'd like to bring up? Yes, please feel free.
Yeah, I would like to just go on the record and perhaps have it forwarded to the council for thought that understanding Lincoln Avenue and the sidewalks are essentially under the jurisdiction of Caltrans, that we are getting a higher and higher proliferation of merchandise creeping out into the sidewalks. And as well as the restaurant tables, which are now started with one deep and are now moving to two deep. And if there could be anything that the city can do or should do to at least make some recognition of that and not to have it controlled only by providing ADA access and nothing more. So it would be interesting to find out what our options might be.
Good point. Anybody else like to bring anything up? Okay, we'll move along. Excuse me. Move along to the director's report.
I'd like to recommend that the commission cancel its October 22nd meeting due to a lack of agenda items.
Okay, I think we will
get a consensus.
Sure.
I think so. And that is all I.
I'll be all by myself if I say yes. So I guess I better say no.
Well, you better come up with a project.
Meeting is canceled. So with that, I will make a motion that we adjourn tonight's regularly scheduled Planning Commission meeting of October 8th and meet again on our next meeting on the 12th of November. Thanks, everybody.